Over the past 10 years, I've made multiple seven figures as a commission-only sales rep in a number of different industries. And in this video, I'm gonna show you the exact strategies that you need in order to close more deals by role-playing live with somebody on an offer that I have no idea about, have never sold before, and have minimal information. The step-by-step strategies of how you can replace skill with process. If you follow this clear and defined process, it's all about you figuring out how to make more sales and make more sales now. So make sure you follow all the way through to the end because it goes through all of the exact systems, steps, and phases that you would need to go through in order to make a sale. So like and subscribe and let me know how you go.
What do you sell?
Joffer.
Yeah. Oh, fun. All right, so trying to save it or what?
Trying to save it, yeah.
Who do you usually talk to, the guy or the girl?
Men.
Yep, and how far gone are they?
Depends. Most of the time is they're about to leave.
Okay, cool. They want to leave or they're going to be left?
The wife leaves.
Okay, cool. And is it like VSL?
Yeah, VSL.
Outbound or like they book straight in?
Book straight in. Just give you some context. We tell them not to talk to their wives because if they do, yeah, it's settled with the divorce.
Okay, we'll see how it goes. How can I help?
Yeah, I'm just, my wife's leaving.
Okay, why is that?
Mate, I'm not too sure. She just, yeah? On Saturday, she just goes, I'm out.
Do you see it coming or is this brand new, like, news to you?
Oh, brand new.
Okay.
I never saw it coming up.
All right. You think you should have?
I'm doing the right things. You know, I work hard for her.
Okay.
You know, I'm working long hours. I provide for the family.
Okay.
You know, I clean the house. I just don't have no idea.
Okay. So walk me through, man. Like, what's been going on?
Yeah. So Saturday night, she just goes, I'm out. Pack the bags.
Okay.
I'm just home with the kids.
Okay. So what kind of, besides that happening, like what actually, or was there anything before? Or is that the catalyst? Like, how'd you book this call?
Yeah. Just online. And I was just searching for therapy.
Okay.
Couples counseling and whatnot. And
okay. And what did you see from us that you're like, okay, they might help?
No, you talked about like how therapy is not effective.
Okay.
You know, we tried that a little bit.
Okay. A little bit?
Yeah, we've done a couple of sessions.
Couple? Together. Like 1, 2, 5, 10?
Yeah, like about 5.
Okay. How did it go?
Yeah.
Did you like it?
No, it's horrible.
Why was it horrible?
This all was on her side.
What do you mean?
The therapist was saying, like, she was on her side of it all the time and she recommended to leave.
Okay. So, that could be trouble.
Yeah.
Okay, and so besides that, like what else have you done to kind of try and kind of keep this going? Well, what outcome do you want?
I want to save my marriage.
Okay.
Of course. Yeah.
Okay.
I want to save my marriage. Yeah, I want to be a better person.
Okay, what have you been doing to try and save your marriage?
I'll try talking to her.
Okay.
Therapy, like I mentioned.
Okay.
I try to, you know, reading books.
Okay.
Yeah, that's about it. I'm just trying to talk to her.
Okay, and just, I guess, so I can understand the rationale behind why you might be looking for someone like us to come in and help you out. Like, why not do that instead of just kind of, you know, accept the fate? You tried a few things, right? Didn't work.
Oh,
say, Levy.
I love her, man.
Okay.
Yeah, I love her, man.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm positive.
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so run me through, like, best case scenario. Like, where do you want to be at in, say, 6-12 months?
Obviously, save the marriage.
Okay.
Communicate better with her.
Yeah, but saving the marriage, like, you know, that could mean, like, be miserable together. What do you actually want?
Happy marriage.
And what does that mean to you?
You know, be able to have a conversation with her, you know, a happy life.
Being able to have a conversation with her?
Yeah.
And have a happy life?
Yeah.
That's very vague.
Yeah, yeah, well.
What does that mean?
I just don't want to argue with her anymore.
Okay, well, you could just shut up and take it.
Well, I can.
Why don't you?
Oh, then that's not life, is it?
Okay, so what do you want?
Well, I want to live a life where we're fucking together, yeah. Going to places. We're not arguing in the restaurant.
Okay.
We're not arguing in front of the kids.
Okay.
Yeah, man. Sick of it, tired of it.
Okay. But again, not arguing is not, doesn't sound great.
Yeah.
Just not arguing.
Yeah.
What do you want?
Not sure.
That could be trouble.
It is.
But if you thought about it though, like you come home, what do you want to happen?
A bit of peace.
Okay.
Want her to respect me.
Okay, she doesn't respect you?
No, well, she's always on my case.
Okay, about what?
Never seem to get anything right.
Okay.
You know, shoes at the wrong place.
Are you always wrong? Are your shoes always in the wrong place?
Not all the time, but.
No, that's that? That's
yeah,
all right.
All the time, but like, it's just all on the case, you know what I mean, right?
So, yeah, for sure.
So yeah, I want to come home and we have dinner together.
And what does she want?
She wants out.
Okay, but before that?
If you really think about it, she's been saying, can I step up a little bit?
Okay, how so?
I think she's saying, can I help around the house?
Did you ask her what she meant for that?
I tried, but...
You tried?
Yeah, I tried. I tried to ask
her. What does that mean? Like you went out and then stopped? Or like you did ask?
How I know. Just ask her what's wrong.
Yep.
You know, how do I fix this? Say? Well, every time I try to fix something, the goalpost keeps changing.
Okay.
Right, so.
You tell her that?
Not all the time.
All the time? When would she say?
She says, she keeps changing the goalpost, man. So.
Okay.
I don't even know what to do anymore.
And so, like, what would you like from us?
How to fix this. I don't have skills. I don't know how to fix this, so.
Okay. What have you done in the past to try and fix it before you started talking to us?
Therapy. You know, just books.
Okay. I want to make sure that what we do. So, like, what are you actually looking for in a kind of a coaching or training program to actually teach you these things. What's the criteria that you need?
Yeah, just someone to tell me what to do.
Okay, just tell you what to do.
I didn't know how to communicate with her, so.
Okay.
Apparently, so, yeah. Plus, I don't know how to do this by myself.
Okay, and how do you like to be communicated with? Like, how can we communicate best to you so that you know that you're getting everything you need in order to actually fix the problem?
Yeah, just someone to talk to. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, someone to talk to, someone to support.
That's pretty vague.
Sure.
I think I'm starting to see the problem, buddy.
Can you?
Right?
Tell me.
Right? You're talking riddles, right? You got to be specific. You got to say what you want. All I've heard from you is that you want to argue less. You haven't really painted much of a picture for me. What do you need from us to put you in the best position possible to be able to actually get your outcome?
Yeah, I need someone to show me what to say.
Okay.
When to say it.
Some sort of accountability measure when you do fuck up. Someone to give you the real,
tea,
as it were.
Yeah, someone to,
as a kid,
just be honest with me.
Okay.
Because I think I'm doing something right, but clearly I'm not.
Clearly you're not.
Yeah,
right?
So I'm here.
Not to say that you're all to blame or she's all to blame, but chances are it's a little bit of column A and B, right? Okay, so let's just say we put you in a position, we give you a person that holds your feet to the fire, holds you accountable, gives you a plan, helps you actually diagnose what's going on, and is your coach the quarterback? Like, what do you foresee? What's a perfect day for you in 3, 6, 12 months where you know this has worked and that you figure out how to effectively communicate with your wife?
The perfect day? Well, perfect day is I come home.
Okay. From what?
From work.
You've missed half the day, mate. It's a perfect day. It's 5 p.m. Jesus Christ, mate.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Fair enough. Perfect day. When we're both at home. On a weekend.
Okay. Yeah, there we go. Now we're going from a work day to a weekend.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're getting better. Yeah, so you wake up.
Yeah.
Then what happens?
Yeah, so.
Morning blowy. Like, what are we talking about? Like, where are we at? That'd be nice, right? Well, you wouldn't say no, would you?
Yeah, well, I haven't been intimate for 2 years. So.
2 years?
Yeah.
Jeez, you want to change that?
Yeah, I do. Man.
You sure?
I promise. Man.
You don't have to.
Yeah, I do.
Now or later?
Now.
Okay. Jesus, man, you look all pent up.
Yeah,
you're about to explode,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah, man. It's hard, man.
All right, so you wake up. So we got more intimacy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What
so,
else?
Waking up and have lunch or breakfast together.
It's quality time.
Yeah, quality time.
What's your love language?
I'm not sure, man. That's the problem.
You don't know. Would you rather be given a gift or told something nice?
Told something nice.
Would you rather be hugged and fucked or told something nice?
Hugged and fucked.
Would you rather get food or hugged and fucked?
Bit of both would be
bit
nice.
Bit of both. There it is. You are acts of service, my friend.
Yeah.
There you go. There's your love language. What's your wife's?
Hopefully it's fucked.
Would she rather be hugged or fucked, or would she rather have a present? Does she want Chanel or the D? Gucci?
Oh, both,
D.
Man.
Bit of both?
Yeah.
Okay. So we got gifts.
Yep.
Right? Does she like words? I can tell you she does. She's a woman.
She likes words.
Do you give her words? No? Why not? You gotta get over that. All right.
No idea.
Okay. Well, there we go. We gotta figure that out. All right. So I guess we gotta figure out how to get you to talk your wife's love language into where you can actually effectively communicate, be more intimate, both, you know, intimately, but also, you know, as a couple, and be able to hold you accountable and actually give you a system and a structure to be able to do that. Is that right?
Yeah.
And with what you have in place right now, how close are you to being able to do that?
Well, she's out, so.
Okay.
She's walked out, so.
Okay.
Probably not close at all.
And what happens if we don't fix that?
Divorce, mate.
Okay, you want to set up for that?
No.
Okay. Do you feel like you have a dog in the fight and that you can change this?
I want to.
You want to? Do you feel like you can?
I can, yeah.
Are you willing to?
I am.
You don't have to. Most men give up.
I need to.
She's given up, why don't you?
That's not who I am.
Okay, well, you know, here you are. So maybe it is a little bit who you are. Are you open to that?
Yeah.
Because you haven't fixed it yet.
Yeah.
You want to fix it now?
Of course.
Later?
No, now.
Now?
Yeah.
You sure?
I am.
Okay, I think that what we do would work then. Do you want to go through it?
I'll do it.
Sweet.
Tell me.
Yeah. Then I'd pitch. Easy.
As it feels a prospect.
Yeah.
That was the fastest sales call I've had in a long time. As a prospect, I feel like it challenged me enough to make me think that shit, I'm the problem, rather than
Well, that was going to be the objection, right? So.
Yeah. So when he challenged me about my love language, I didn't know what it was, but I knew what it was, but I didn't. So when he challenged me, I had to say it out loud.
You keep those dark moments lighthearted.
Yeah.
Little joke. You want to be hugged or fucked, or do you want, you know what I mean? So say things like that, because like I could say, is your love language physical touch? Yeah. I could say, do you want to open in the morning? Like, you know, like these are funny things that we try and say to break tension because it's a difficult time for the prospect. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like we're going to give them a little break and allow them a little bit of a break in the darkness with a little bit of humor because, you know, when the world's crashing down around you, having someone make you laugh is a nice thing. You can't be doom and gloom with these guys, man.
Yeah.
If you do, they're just going to break. You have to be happy.
Some sort of touch when you say doom and gloom.
That's why if you pain sell with these guys, like if you just go deep on the pain, like it's easy, man. You can make them cry. Doesn't mean they're gonna buy, because only happy people buy. Had to be hope.
That's what I find, like, when they really do the glue, they can't see it. They can't see, like, in the mind, it's just they're out, really. They can't see the light, so.
Awesome. Sweet.
Thank you.
Do you wanna do an analysis or breakdown or whatever? Ask any questions?
Do you wanna break down like what you're doing? So that's one part of it, like using some humor into it. But do you wanna break down like other things you're doing?
So the initial part was just trying to find out like why he's there. And he was just super vague. So just kind of keep dawdling around. Like you could see the structure, right? It was just situation questions. Like, what are you doing? Where you're at? He sort of started going down the wrong road. For me, like he was just blaming his wife nonstop. So in my head, I was like, well, that's the objection. So that's the one thing I can't let him do. I have to make him take some level of responsibility without like kicking him with it, because like that, it would just like, he would push back too much if I like wailed him on it and was like, well, you know, it always takes two. So you got to kind of like chip away at that and do it nice and like slowly, because I have the whole call, right? Like I've got the whole 20, 30 minutes, whatever. And he was going into like his current scenario, right? Which is his current situation. But like really the situation that you want is sort of more like, what are you doing to solve the problem? So we had to sort of get him into that. And then he was like therapy, all these other things. And then we just went like, do you like it? No, yes, okay, cool. Rationale question pretty quickly within like 2 or 3 minutes, which is usually how it goes, because the problem is pretty self-evident. So you don't need to go too into it. Problem is you have a shitty marriage. Like, yeah, I get it, right? That's the problem. Then it's like rationale, why not just give up? That's, you know, like why look at getting someone like us in instead of just giving up? No, I'm just kind of taking it, because that seems to me like a very likely outcome. And so I have to make him say why he doesn't want the likely outcome. In my head, that made sense. Because you could ask that a ton of different ways. Like, why go with us over, you know, trying more therapy? But it's like, he's already tried therapy. So like, that seems like a throwaway. But like the worst case scenario is that he gives up entirely. So like, that seemed to me in my head, that's the rationale that I used in my head to deal with that. And then it was about getting an outcome. And he was very, very not wanting to get me an outcome. And so I just had to keep asking the same questions in different ways. And just asking and asking and asking and asking and asking until he felt comfortable enough with me to where I could actually get something out of him. Then I went into like criteria, right? Ideal criteria. Like, what do you want from us? Like, what do you need from us? Again, he was shitty. So like just had to kind of pull some more stuff out of him and then label it, right? So pull the stuff out, label it like, okay, so you need this, you need this, you need this. Yep, sweet. Those would have been the pillars that I would have used in my pitch, right? So just take him, label it. So then it sounds like the pitch is for him specifically, which would always help make the sale. And then it was like, I don't really need much consequence, because like, I know that like he's well aware of the consequence because he's living it right now. So it was more about getting him to like future pace himself into more success. All right, like what does he want? What does he really want? So because like he's already living his consequence. So like, you know, he's the wife's left. He's living the consequence. You could have gone into kids and all that kind of stuff, which I didn't do, but probably just because I've been up for a very long time, but that would have been helpful. I think it didn't need it though. It just felt like I had enough. So like, why?
Yeah, generally they're living the life of it. When they come on the call, they're like shattered.
Yeah. So you don't want to like, you don't want to turn the screws too hard, because only people with a bit of hope buy. Miserable people aren't going to spend money. You know what I mean? It's just more pain to feel.
Hold their head underwater as long as we can.
Not necessarily. Like, you know, you got a bit of a radar, right? Like, you know, you can feel it. If the problem is, if you push people like that too hard, they become quite miserable.
I feel like I've backed off on calls. What happened, you know, when I was working for you? Crying in tears, crocodile tears, find out later.
No, it's not necessarily. That's a bad attitude. People want to move towards the good, right? Like,
it's not real tears if you're giving them a real solution and they don't want to do it.
Well, maybe.
It's my crocodile tears.
Yeah, no, I sort of understand what you're saying, but the hope of the solution, and then it's like the consequence, and also like, you know, with fitness, there's the fear of success as well, which is stuff that's like difficult to dive into, you know? So like they're deeply thinking, well, what if I lose the weight and no one loves me still, right? That's a real thing for a lot of people. They eat themselves to death for a reason, mate. Like they're not happy people. And you're definitely not gonna overcome a lot of that on a 45 minute sales call. Like, so it's easy to break. It's easy. Well, you talk to a lot of 18,000 sales calls a month on that thing. Like the rarity is a lot, right? And I've done a lot of fitness sales, and fitness is so emotional. It's a very emotional sale, and you have to get the right balance of hope. I really don't take people that far into like negative. I focus far more on positive because I feel like it's a better motivator.
I have a question. What happens if you do take them to miserable, like in the solution phase?
Solution phase is only positive.
But I'm saying, what happens if you do go too miserable and they are too sad? What happens? What does that do with the bottom of the sales call?
It just means like people lose faith in themselves, right? Like if you just like fucking, you know, like they have to know that they can do it. So you've got like Taylor Welch calls it the buying pocket, right? So you like they have enough belief in themselves to where they know they can do it, but they need help. If they're too arrogant, they're just going to do the DIY. But if they go too far this way, they just lose belief in themselves.
I'm not burying them on you can't do this. I'm burying them on you. Diabetes. You're going to lose your left eye, you can lose your left leg.
Yeah.
You won't be able to work anymore, that's going to be a financial issue. By the way, is your partner willing to help you with this, look after you? Do you know how many women that would turn around to me? I would say 60-70% of them, my partner willing to look after me if I had lost my leg due to diabetes.
Yeah.
Or anyone. So going in on that, I'm on board that.
Not yeah, so
I don't see that. So I don't know what you're saying. Is the way I'm translating is it? Don't go in too hard because they'll give up hope. But if I'm
no, it's not. It's everything is contextual to the tonality of the conversation that you're having, right? Like it's all you got to be able to read people. So like, I knew I had enough. I know when I have enough. You can tell by the way that people hold themselves, by the way that they talk, the how much of their throat they're used, by the hesitations in their voice, by the way they look, the direction they're looking, like it's human interaction. You know what I mean? Like I know when someone is actually contemplating their real life consequences. Doctors have millions of conversations every single day with people saying, if you don't change this, you're gonna die. If you don't stop smoking, you're gonna die. You're on the road to lung cancer. The guy gets out of the thing, goes fucking like that, right? Like, they don't give a fuck, mate. Like, those consequences, they live with them their entire life. They don't care. You think fat people care about dying from fat diseases? They don't, man. Otherwise, they wouldn't be fat. They don't give a shit, mate.
You know, sometimes I've had many calls where I've got no clothes, and they've gone to me, Adrian, you just changed the way I think.
Yeah, that's a win, though.
No,
so, yeah, it doesn't mean people are going to buy. Like, the thing is, you can do everything perfectly and they won't buy. And you can fuck everything up and they will. The answer is like, yeah, sometimes they just don't. There's nothing you can do about it. And it's fine. All you can do is what you think is going to work a good chunk of the time.
I'm happy with that call. When they say you change my way of thinking.
Exactly.
I've got so much on financially right now and that's going to put me on.
Yeah.
I just can't.
The key is for them to want it at the end. If that's your goal, then like they just got to want it. You know what I mean? And then like, you know, the chips will fall as they may type thing, right? And the better you get, the more you get them to want it essentially. And the more you learn how to read where they're at, you know what I mean? But like I am someone who is far more of a solution-based seller than I am a consequence, because I don't need to spend much time in consequence, because the way that I ask consequence questions are quite like telling. And I make someone tell me like 10 times throughout a call they're gonna do it. He told me like five times that now is the time he needs to do it. You sure? You don't have to. You want to? Now? Later? Okay. Like constantly, right? So it's all his idea.
How are you, say what you said again, I'm more of a solution-based.
I'm more of a solution-based.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, because I don't focus on the problem that much. I really don't, as you can see, right? I focus far more on getting a detailed vision of what the future would be. I focus more on that, personally.
What's condemnation?
Like, sort of like, how dare you? Like, you can't be frustrated by people. Frustration is impossible to hide. Like if you're frustrated by somebody not moving forward, like first of all, how dare you? Like really, who the fuck are you, right? Tell me what to do. Why? Fuck you. Just because like it makes sense in your head doesn't mean it makes sense in their head. They might do things that like you wouldn't do. What if they go and visit their mother every day? Why don't you? Well, because, you know, you should do that. Yeah, I probably should. Why don't you? Right? So like, no one's perfect. Everyone's doing things that they can be doing better, and they're probably doing something a lot better than what you are, and vice versa. And just because it makes sense in your head doesn't mean it makes sense in their head. And you shouldn't be frustrated that they don't want to do something that you think they should do because you had a 45-minute chat with them. Like, it's ridiculous.
You can show an element of frustration.
No, you shouldn't.
At the end of the call.
No, you shouldn't. No, it's wrong. You're wrong. But okay. No, you're wrong.
When I'm saying, you know, Matt, you know, I want to try and figure out a way, you know, logistic, finance, for instance.
Frustration is like, is very different than like problem solving. It's so more. Doesn't mean it's not frustrating because you want to make the sale.
It's not even about that, it's frustrating.
It's definitely a little bit about it.
I really want
to. Definitely a little bit though. It's definitely a little bit though, right? A little bit?
And the problem right now with your husband, do you want your husband?
Yeah. It's definitely a little bit about the sale, though. No. 2%?
Well, that's my problem. I've got that into my head. It's not about the sale.
Yeah.
Financially now, because I've worked hard and got myself, when I was struggling financially,
yeah,
it was all about the sale.
There you go.
That was killing me.
Yeah.
Killing me.
Yeah.
I have people slamming the phone down.
Yeah.
Left, right, and center.
Yeah, yeah.
But when the finances are there, not where I want them to be, but they're not bad anymore, I don't care.
Sweet. Then the frustration comes from wanting them to do the choice that you think is best for them.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but who the fuck are you to know what's best for them?
That's why I'm on the call with you. I do know what's best for you.
You don't.
Well, I know that if you're quite stone overweight and you've got type 2 diabetes, you need to do something about it.
For sure. But you don't know that this is best for them. You have a decent idea, but again, you don't know. And you don't know all the circumstances and you don't know their entire life and you don't know them well enough. Again, what I think is totally irrelevant. Like it doesn't matter. I don't have a dog in this fight. I don't care. So therefore, there will be nothing but genuine curiosity in my questioning. There will be no frustration ever because I don't give a fuck what you do. If that prospect dies tomorrow, I will not know. And if I die tomorrow, they will not know. And they won't give a fuck. If I died tomorrow, Brian would be a little sad for like a week, for sure. Because we know each other quite well. And you guys in a month's time would be like, you remember that Matt guy? Yeah, he was pretty good at sales. And that'd be it.
Still watching YouTube.
Yeah, exactly. Someone to get that revenue. Right? I'd be like, remember that Matt guy? Yeah, he had some good YouTube. Is that still up? Didn't he fucking die? Yeah, he died. That's weird, right? That's what would happen. We're all insignificant little fucking things on a big old fucking rock hurtling through space. And the sooner you realize that, doesn't mean that individually we're not important in our own spheres, right? And we're not valued. But you do not have the right to fucking tell that person how they should live their life in the same way that I don't have the right to tell you, you don't have the right to tell me, right? All you can do is present a good enough cogent argument and maybe they move forward. If you think that you know best, you will be frustrated. They will feel it, they will hear it. I don't care if it's because you want them to have the best for them, but they are going to think it's because you want the sale. There is no other context. And you can say, this isn't about the sale, but it's a little about the sale, right? And whether it's about you getting the money or but about winning, right? Like, there's no way that you don't overcome that context.
You had a good call with them. You built a good relationship around. You do, if you're frustrated
maybe
at the start of the call, forget about it.
Yeah.
If you're frustrated
maybe
at the end of the call, you had a good call with them and you built up rapport, etc.
Maybe, yeah.
I think they...
Could be true. To me, no. But to you, yes. I don't give a fuck if you think the same way I do. But to me, that's what helps me never be frustrated on a call.
Just disclaimer, everyone. Definitely don't go.
Yeah. Oh, we talk about this all the time. I have to speak to Adrian, right? I know what kind of questions he asks. But like, you know, it maybe. You know what I mean? The answer is yeah, maybe. I don't know. Fuck, everyone's different. Everyone comes off in a different way.
Quick question, man. You talked about the problem you flew pretty quick, especially in my offer. They tend to blur about, obviously, you take to get to love, but how much is enough problem before we move
it? I don't know. That much? As much as I got? Depends how good you are.
On that, on a setting call, if you're setting an appointment up and you get the problem 3-4 minutes in,
set the call.
Just set the call up.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah. Set the call. Every word you say is a chance for you to fuck it up. Just speak less.
So I think, Matt, because I know you tell me that all the time too. I remember when I was like, man, I'm so frustrated because like these people aren't buying. And then you're like, Brian, like how much money you make? I'm like, I made this amount. I was like, then why the fuck are you frustrated? So I think I logically get that. I think I'm getting it more now. But I think when people are taking back-to-back calls throughout the day, then now they get in the heat of the moment. And then like they get more frustrated.
Yeah, but it's arrogance, man. To think that you should know best for somebody is fucking ridiculous, in my opinion.
That's a good call though, what Brian said. When you're on the back end of a 10-hour day,
yeah,
and it's all gone wrong way.
Man, I'm on the back end of a fucking 16-hour day. I'm fine, right? Again, I don't think that my opinion is very important to other people. I think like I'm pretty good at sales. So like I can argue my position, but I do not care if you agree with me. I don't give a fuck. Agree, disagree. All right, sweet man. Like whatever, like I don't care. Like every context and every scenario is different. Like on one call, yeah, maybe. On another call, yeah, maybe. You know what I mean? So like the thing is like, I've just come to a place in my life where I don't give a fuck. And that's a very good place to be when it comes to selling. Because like every single call is the same. Like I don't bring drama from one call to the other. I don't make any assumptions based on this person because of the 400 calls, which means I don't assume that I know what they say when they say X and Y and Z that I've heard 10 times because maybe they mean it a slightly different way. And so I don't probe and I don't clarify. I don't find out what they mean, which means I never get to the real heart of the problem. Because I'm making a series of assumptions that are probably incorrect, or maybe they're not. I don't know. So I might as well just ask the question.
What happened that shifted for you? Because I think, you know, you're probably the only person who can deal with that mindset. All of us are still caught up in all of the emotions. What shifted for you?
Do you want to be liked? I don't.
Naturally, I guess the answer is yes.
Yeah. Is that it? There you go, mate.
Was there a time where that it was like that for you?
Yeah, for sure.
How did that change? You just...
I think it just comes from like a realization that like people are very complex things, right? And so to pretend that we can diagnose, unravel, and fix in 40 minutes is like abhorrently stupid. Like people are so complex. Like I'm one of the only people that I know that have a loving family, come from a well-to-do background when I was a kid, had everything I could possibly have, and then went to kill people for a living and totally fine doing it. I have like almost no psychological scars from doing that, right? Everyone else came from horrific backgrounds for the most part, like 95% of them, right? Same as salespeople. Most people here probably had quite not super pleasant upbringings, right? That's what salespeople are. Everyone's so complex, and their behavioral systems and why they do certain things is such a complex pattern. And if I was you and you were me, we would be each other. If I grew up like you, I'd be much more like you. If you grew up like me, you'd be much more like me. It just comes from a place of compassion. Like, people fuck up, people make mistakes, people don't make the right choice. If they did, we'd all have 8 packs and fucking 8 figures in our bank, right? Driving fucking Lambos and shit. So like, you know, people don't really inherently make really good decisions, but it's because like, they probably just didn't have all the building blocks to do so. And when you have children and you watch how easy it is to mold and manipulate kids to be good, bad, indifferent, you know what I mean, malevolent, you know, like you can do all those things if you want to. If you want to raise a gay preacher, mate, it's pretty easy. Like you can do that. You can make that person a gay preacher if you want. They're just malleable little things that you can turn into whatever you want. So it's like, you gotta, how do you turn them into good people? So then when you see someone make a really shitty decision, you just go, oh, I wonder what happened there. And it's just a bit more compassionate. And so like, compassion.